sing right after the children's sermon.
Right after the sermon. And before the scripture reading.
Before the reading.
Good morning. I greet you in the name of Jesus Christ, our Lord and Savior. Welcome to the Sunday morning services at the Gibson City United Methodist Church. A warm welcome to those listening over WGCY and those viewing over Facebook live stream. My name is Jennifer Arsenault, and I will be your liturgist this morning. We have several announcements to make. There will be a order form out in the narthex for Danish Kringle, and the proceeds from this fundraiser will go to the Shriners. Let's see, also in your bulletin, the altar flowers are shared with us today by Jim and Amy Hood. They are to celebrate Mary Ann Hood's 90th birthday on October 26th. Happy birthday, Mary Ann. They are also to celebrate Joel and Sharon's wedding celebration, which took place yesterday, or I'm sorry, on October 22nd. Charge conference. Our annual charge conference will be held on Saturday, November 6th at 10:45. And then the following items are dates. So if you don't have a bulletin, you may want to grab a pencil and paper to write some dates down. Daylight savings time. Do not forget to set your clocks back an hour at 3 a.m. on Sunday morning, November 7th, or maybe just do that Saturday before you go to bed. There will be a chili and vegetable soup dinner to honor our local police men and women, firefighters, and EMTs. This will be held on Tuesday, November 16th from 5 to 7. If you are interested in helping provide desserts or able to help serve that evening, please contact Gary or the church office. We have several special worship weekends in November to take note of. November 7th will be our All Saints celebration, where we will lift up the names of those members who passed away within the last year. There will also be an opportunity for anyone wishing to lift up names of additional loved ones. Then the following weekend in November, the 13th and the 14th, will be Harvest Weekend. We will take time to celebrate the harvest on that weekend, and we are asking for food donations for the emergency food pantry at Shepherd's Closet. Messiah and Festival of Lessons and Carols. The Gibson Area Music Foundation is planning a special and different type of Christmas program this year. This year's event will offer a few much-loved selections from Handel's Messiah, along with a festival of lessons and carols that will tell the Christmas story through carols and scripture. The performance will be held Sunday, December 5th at 3 p.m. at the Gibson City Bible Church. But if you are interested in singing with the choir, rehearsals are Monday evenings at 7 p.m. starting October 25th, that's starting tomorrow. But the rehearsals will be at the First Presbyterian Church here in Gibson City. All right, let's see. I think I have one more announcement. I am going to read this. This comes from our friend Susan Schultz. And she says, "Dear church family, as one of your candidates for ordained ministry, I want to share that our conference board of ordained ministry approved me to enter the next stage of the process. They find me ready for vocational ministry. And if the full clergy session votes to accept the board's recommendation, I will be commissioned as a provisional deacon of the UMC at annual conference in June 2022. This next stage is to discern effectiveness in ministry, and when working full-time takes 2 years to complete. I do not expect to serve full-time, so it will probably be more like 4 years, which she says sounds like a long time. This is a big step in the discernment process. You are part of my story. I did not get where I am today without you and the Holy Spirit. Thank you for your prayers, support, and encouragement. Thank you for being my companions on this journey. I look forward to seeing what God has in store for each of us in the future. Susan Schultz." So congratulations to Susan, and please continue to be in prayer for Susan. All right, I think that's all of our announcements. So, are you ready to praise and worship our Lord? Please rise if you are able for our call to worship. Our call to worship comes from Psalm 34. "I will bless the Lord at all times. God's praise shall continually be in my mouth. My soul makes its boast in the Lord. Let the afflicted hear and be glad. Oh, magnify the Lord with me, and let us exalt God's name together. I sought the Lord, who answered me, and delivered me from all my fears. Look to God and be radiant, so your faces shall never be ashamed. The poor cried out, and the Lord heard and saved them out of all their troubles. The angel of the Lord encamps around those who fear God and delivers them. Taste, see, the Lord is good. Happy are those who take refuge in God. Oh, fear the Lord, you his holy ones, for those who fear God have no want. The young lions suffer want and hunger, but those who seek the Lord lack no good thing. Come, O children, listen to me. I will teach you the fear of the Lord. Which of you desires life and covets many days to enjoy good? Keep your tongue from evil and your lips from speaking deceit. Depart from evil and do good. Seek peace and pursue it. The eyes of the Lord are on the righteous. The ears of the Lord hear their cries. The face of the Lord is against evildoers, to cut off the remembrance of them from the earth. When the righteous cry for help, the Lord hears and delivers them out of all their troubles. The Lord is near to the brokenhearted and saves the crushed spirit. Many are the afflictions of the righteous, but the Lord delivers them. The Lord keeps all their bones, not one of them is broken. Evil shall slay the wicked, and those who hate the righteous will be condemned. The Lord redeems the life of the servants. None of those who take refuge in God will be condemned. Now please remain standing for our opening hymn, My Hope is Built, number 368.
Set right next to you if it's all right, okay? Then you can help me up when you get up, okay? Girls, you can come right up here. I'm not going to bother you. Well, much. Anywhere you'd like. Or stand up right here. I don't care if you stand up or sit down. It doesn't matter. Has anybody ever asked you guys, where are you from? Where are you from? Where do you come from? where do you call home? What's the name of the town? Gibson City.
Champagne. Champagne.
Like Champagne or Champagne?
Champagne, Illinois.
Champagne, Illinois. Do you live in a town? Do you? Is it far from here? You have to ride in a car to get here? Yeah, do you know the name of your town? What is it? Could you tell me? Saybrook, Illinois. There's somebody else here from Saybrook. That man right there is from Saybrook. So you got neighbors, people from Saybrook right here, so you're not alone. Isn't that neat? Okay, two towns. And Colfax, another wonderful town, isn't it? Yes, I've been to, they have a bowling alley in Colfax. Did you know that? Wow, it's super small. Have you ever visited another place? And what I mean by that, like, what's the favorite town of all your towns that you like to go to? What is the favorite town? Have you got one? A place you really like to go. You have two? You have one? Thank you.
Gibson City.
Gibson City. He likes to leave Champagne and come to Gibson City. I don't blame you there. All right. Have one? Now think, you've been on a vacation or driven somewhere, and the town that I like to go to, let's see, just to hang around and, you know, have fun in. I think San Francisco, California was one of the funnest towns. But there was somebody with me when I went to that town. And I think that was as much a part of being in the town that made it special for me. It was the people that were around me in that town. I think that's why I like the town. Do you know in heaven, you've heard of heaven? It's where God is and where people go to spend all the rest of their lives. Well, I hope that's, you bring up a good point. All people. She said not all people. Well, I'm hoping God invites all people. And I hope people accept that invitation to come and be with him in heaven. Oh, not before their time. I agree with you. Not right now, but one day we're all going to be invited by God to come to heaven. I think it's going to be neat in heaven. There's lots and lots of people I know that have already gone to heaven, people I love. Oh, my mom and my dad are a couple of the people. I like to play the guitar, and I have a lot of friends who have died that knew how to play the guitar and sing that have gone to heaven. No, heaven's good. Let me share with you. Don't ever believe heaven's bad. Oh, she's all right. You know, there's two words we use in church. Heaven is the good place. Hell is the bad place. That's where the devil is. So I just want you to know that today. Thanks for bringing that up. That was important. Now, next time you go to a place and you kind of like it, think about the people who you're with, who you're spending time with. And I bet that city or that place will be that much more special. And if you don't see somebody that you know, don't be afraid to smile at someone to make their day better. Have you got a smile? She gave me a half smile. Okay, well, I'll take it. Have you got a smile? Oh, it's beautiful. I can't see it except through your eyes. That's cool. You got a smile? What a great smile that is. Hey, pray with me. I'm going to pray and you say what I say after I say it. God, thank you for my town. Or that place that I like to go to. Thank you for the people that go with me to those places. And thank you for sending your son Jesus so I can appreciate everything you do for me. That's a big word. You can get this part. Amen. Okay, thanks for coming up. It's great to be with you. Oh, you say, oh, excuse me, I've been, it's amen, not amen. Okay. Well then, well, goodness sakes. Oh, I've been schooled.
Please rise for our scripture reading, which comes from the book of Mark, chapter 10, verses 46 through 52. Then they came to Jericho. As Jesus and his disciples, together with a large crowd, were leaving the city, a blind man, Bartimaeus, which means son of Timaeus, was sitting by the roadside begging. When he heard that it was Jesus of Nazareth, he began to shout, "Jesus, son of David, have mercy on me." Many rebuked him and told him to be quiet, but he shouted all the more, "Son of David, have mercy on me." Jesus stopped and said, Call him. So they called to the blind man, "Cheer up, on your feet, he's calling you." Throwing his cloak aside, he jumped to his feet and came to Jesus. "What do you want me to do for you?" Jesus asked him. The blind man said, "Rabbi, I want to see." "Go," said Jesus, "your faith has healed you." Immediately, he received his sight and followed Jesus along the road. The word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God.
Let's sing.
Come on and follow me. Come on and
when you know it's Jesus? What happens when you know it's Jesus? Okay, I've got a list here to start this morning. And how many of you have been lifelong Illinoisans? Lifelong, okay, the majority of us. So I'm going to say some towns, and raise your hand if you've ever been there, okay? Shawneetown, Illinois. Shawneetown. Okay, where is it?
Way down south.
By Carbondale? Is that a good picture? It's not real far from Carbondale. It's a little bit south and east of Carbondale. Within 40 minutes. Is that fair? Okay. How about Cahokia? Have you ever heard of that? Where is that? South again, but on the other side of the state, down by St. Louis. And in 1816 is when Shawneetown became the first town in Illinois, and it was really in 1748 they found it. Had the first established bank in the state of Illinois, Shawneetown. Cahokia Mounds is probably what we're most familiar with, right? And it was established by a Native American tribe. And this, I found this kind of neat about a connection. It was the most sophisticated pre-Columbian civilization north of Mexico. And during the time, about 1,000 years ago, during that time, at its height, it had more people than London, England, had in it. That little area, when you drive down to St. Louis and you see the mounds, that's hard to envision. Here's one for you. Can anybody tell me where Kaskaskia is? Kaskaskia, Illinois. Chris is pointing like this all over. No, no, okay. Who said southern over here? Somebody. Yeah, right, right, Chris. Chris, Kim. I'll call you anything, won't I? The 2010 census said it was the second least incorporated town in the state of Illinois. So how many you think live there? 14. Yeah, that's pretty cool, isn't it? Now those in Valley City don't know how to react to that booming population because their population is 12. That's the lowest. This is kind of neat. I never knew this. It's just right on the Illinois border. Cape Girardeau, if I say Cape Girardeau, it's a little south of that. Is it okay? And so it's got a 618 area code for the telephones. It's got a Missouri zip code. I found that really interesting. And even having a Missouri zip code, the Illinois Department of Transportation is in charge of the roads going in there. Just kind of information that I know you're going to talk about at dinner. Okay. Edwardsville. Anybody know where Edwardsville is? Okay. Thomas Kirkpatrick moved to that area, and he named it because he had a good friend, Neenan Edwards, Edwardsville. He became governor of the state of Illinois. Says, fun fact here, from that area right there, we have had 5 Illinois governors come. I think it's time we got another downstate governor. Oh, that's political. I can't talk like that. Oh, that's right. Now, here's one. Barrington, Illinois. Anybody know where Barrington is? Chris? It's north. It's north of Schaumburg. Does that help? Originally, this area was settled by the Potawatomi, another Native American tribe that settled there, and they paid the tribe $100,000 for the land And it was then settled by pioneers that came out of New York. Kind of neat. Are you riveted? Aren't you loving this? Okay, stay with me. How about Palestine, Illinois? Anybody know where Palestine is? Okay, Ella does. There's a Mullins dressing. Have you ever heard of Mullins dressing? That's the hometown for Mullins dressing. Incidentally, it's worth going to. There's about four downtown shops that this eccentric, that's a good word, eccentric artist, I mean just folk art, he loves to do things. And I noticed as we walked through his art exhibit, for $10,000, you can buy a fish. Now it's about 4 foot long, this fish, but it's made out of beer caps. Now, worth 10 grand in my book, right? That's Palatine, Illinois. Says, it was named because the name means the land of milk and honey. Pretty cool. Have you ever heard of Peoria? Okay, I'm not going to talk too much about Peoria. Is that your favorite town outside Gibson City? Okay, just checking. All right. Now, do you pronounce it Cairo or Cairo? Yeah, well, I'm just asking because it's pronounced both ways. And this little town started in 1818. Charles Dickens actually visited this place and found nothing good about it. I thought that was interesting. Through the ages, it has been known as a town where people got lynched. Well, a reason not to go, right? And now it has fallen under desperate financial disrepair. And so, Cairo, Cairo, it's depressing. Now, you've been to this town, Alton, Illinois. You know where Alton is? Okay. Alton is over on the Mississippi River, about an hour north of St. Louis, right? Following me? One of its all-time claim to fame is they once had the world's tallest man. And there's a statue there, and he's got a cane, and his cane's as tall as I am, okay? So, now the last place, Carthage, Illinois. These are the top 10 places, earliest places in the state of Illinois. Carthage. Has anyone ever heard of Joseph Smith? Yeah, that guy, the golden tablets, and okay, just religious. Joseph Smith and his brother-in-law were on their way to Springfield to face charges of polygamy. Okay, you with me? While in the jail at Carthage, and you can go, the jail is there. The Seventh Day Adventists come there by the busloads. It's literally a place for them to visit, and it means a lot to them in their religion. A mob took the jail at night and shot Joseph Smith and his brother there. So that's kind of some Carthage history. Now you're wondering, why did I go to all that trouble to make you think of towns that were early in our Illinois history? Places that mattered. Remember the town that was lifted up? Jenny said the town where this blind man was. Do you remember the name of it? That was a clue. There we go. Okay, I was whistling. Joshua fit the battle of Jericho. I found this fascinating. It is believed by many, many scholars that that is the oldest town, city, metropolis, whatever you want to call it, in the world. How old do you think Jericho might be? We're talking a couple hundred years in Illinois, except for the ruins at Cahokia Mounds, but 11,000 years old. That blow you away? It did me. I mean, woolly mammoths were walking around when Jericho was there. I think Jericho was one of those places that Jesus would have answered the children's sermon question. If there's a town where you really like to go, where is it, Jesus? And he would say, well, by all means, Jericho. Jericho. Well, I learned a little bit about Jericho. Well, I already knew it, but this might be new to you. There's a story in the Bible about this guy walking along the road, and he gets robbed and beaten and left for dead. Anybody remember that story? It's the story of the Good Samaritan. Whew. The Good Samaritan was abducted and beaten and robbed on the Jericho Road. Did you know that? Well, maybe you did, but it's kind of, when you think about it, it's an important road that it made it into the Bible several times. Its claim to fame, big claim to fame, was probably a guy by the name of Joshua. You've heard about this Old Testament. And he decided to fight a battle there at Jericho to take the city over. Joshua fit the battle of... I just whistled it. Okay. Yeah, sing it. This blind man's story happened in Jericho. I think it's a pretty big town to talk about. And I know that was a walk around to get you to think about important places in your lives. I do that because they matter. Those places matter, and it mattered to Jesus to go to Jericho. And I don't know why he was there. Maybe sightseeing. Wouldn't you love to see a city that was 11,000 years old and know the history and get to know the people there? You know what I would really like to do is walk through the market. I'd love to see what was in that market, because Jericho, being the oldest city, had to have a thriving economic base, right? Had to have a heck of a community center, a place where people gathered. A lot of different religions would have been there. It would have been a cool place just to go and hang out and talk to people. Well, as I studied, there's a Jericho and a new Jericho, and they're just about a valley apart. Some biblical scholars think that this story about the blind man happened in New Jericho. Doesn't matter, because the Jericho Road, as we know it, began at Jericho, 880 feet below sea level. And it climbed all the way up. The highest part of the Jericho Road is found on a place called the Mount of Olives. Oh, how many have heard of that place? Okay. All along the route, the Romans had stations, check stations. Some of them were tax stations where you'd have to stop and pay a tax to be on this Jericho Road. But where do you think it ended? Jerusalem. That's where it went. Jerusalem is about 1,300 feet above sea level. So you're going from, let's just round it off, 1,000 feet below sea level to 1,300 feet. It climbs out of that valley pretty good, doesn't it? And I can imagine Jesus being the kind of guy wanting to be around folks, going to the most populated city in the area. Now let's talk about this story a little bit. Here we have, and I'm thinking, I could be wrong. I've been wrong before. Somebody needs to say amen. That's right. I admit it. I own it. But I'm thinking Jesus was walking through the area that I wanted to visit. It's where all the vendors would have been. It's where the farmers came in to sell their produce. It would have been where you could have bought just about anything you wanted. You know what, though? I did read that this predates pottery. In that region, So I couldn't have bought a pot yet. Well, maybe by Jesus's day I could have. Anyway, let's talk about this aspect of it. Do you think it's crowded? I mean, you imagine a city. Walk down Michigan Avenue, Chicago, 3 days before Christmas. Have you ever done that? You can't walk down Michigan Avenue. It's so crowded. Try to make your way into Marshall Fields. I don't even know if it's still there. Anybody know? It's not. It's gone. It's called Macy's now. Okay. But you get in the picture. I think it would have been those kinds of crowds. No doubt, Jesus' reputation has preceded him. And there is a big to-do because Jesus is walking down the street. And how many blocks do you think it was for word to travel to the blind man who's sitting against a wall, probably a mud wall, holding his cloak in his lap, and he hears the word, Jesus is coming. Now, I tell you what, there's people right here in this town that heard if Jesus was coming, wouldn't even turn a head or an ear. They wouldn't even care. Remember, there was no internet, there was no telephones. Very few people were literate, so it had to be word of mouth saying, God's son is going to walk by here. What would you do if you knew that? Now, Jenny, this is just me in reading that passage. That one little phrase when they're talking about it, they shouted. Remember what it was they shouted? Jesus is coming! It wasn't, hey, Jesus is coming. There's a lot of excitement, a lot of to-do put up over it, and I would imagine everybody was, even if they hadn't heard, were asking, who's Michael Jordan? Okay, who's this Jesus guy? But the blind man knew. And he took complete advantage of a situation because he heard Jesus was in the house. I say that in an all-white congregation. I think in a black church it would have been different. I'll say it again. Jesus is in the house. Oh, okay. Well, I don't know if it's the same effect when I have to ask twice. But it was that kind of excitement for the blind man, a superstar. A superstar was coming down the road. And what happened when he got there? He started yelling. You know, Jesus, Jesus, here I am, Jesus. What'd the disciples do? Hey, you're not worthy to talk to him. Hey, shh, 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 he'll hear you. I pray to God when I cry, Jesus hears me. Amen? Oh, boy. And Jesus stopped, and he told all that whole group. Now, I'm thinking it had to be hundreds, if not thousands of people around there. And he stopped and said, hey, come here. I love the passage. He didn't get up bent and broken and just barely make his way over to Jesus. This blind guy got up and ran. When was the last time you saw a blind person run? You don't see it happen very often. Why? You all know, don't you? But he ran to Jesus. And Jesus, matter of fact, meeting him where he is, in all that he was, says this. Hey, buddy, what can I do for you? It was so cool. It was not, I am Jesus, the Son of God, the Most High. I am the one. No, no, it was, hey, what do you want? What do you need? Now, I've got a sidebar here about what I've learned about us. I can say us because I live in Gibson City right now. And, you know, we are a prideful people. And sometimes I believe that pride gets in the way. Now, we have well over $5,000 that has been given to us for flood relief. Now, I know for some of you, you're thinking, well, that's a drop in the bucket. I think it's a pretty good sum because that money has come mostly from United Methodist Churches in our Illinois Great Rivers Conference that would call and say, hey, what do you need? And I said, probably money would be good, right? Money's not bad. I've deduced we're a prideful people because guess how many requests we've had from people to help them? Five? You are so optimistic. One individual came to us, and we are bending some rules that we have on benevolence giving. We are, because of the flood. If you were in the flood and you lost everything, we'd love to try to help you if we can. And there was one man who came to us who needed to move because his house had been condemned. The place where he lived was condemned. And he didn't have enough money for the month's rent as a retainer. You know, if you've ever rented, you know the landlords want you to put up more money. And so we helped him. Now, hear this, and if you're listening on the radio or watching on Facebook, the way we help is you come in and you tell us your need. And we aren't just going to hand over cash to everybody who walks through the door. I want to be upfront about this. We've learned a lesson about that. But you tell us what we need, and we're going to do everything we can to help you get it. So you tell us your need. We sent the landlord the money, and he's in his new apartment right now because of people believing so much that we can make a difference. And many of you are sitting in there, I wish preacher wouldn't have told him we had money to give away. Well, I'm glad I did because it's not my money, and they expect us to give it away to help people. Just like this guy, he got up, he ran to Jesus. I need some help. Well, it's obvious he's blind, and Jesus asks the question. You remember? What do you need? He could have said anything. That's an important line in Scripture because before we ask Jesus, we need to figure out what we need. Make sense? It's just a biblical example. I want to see. Remember the words that followed this? Your faith has healed, not made you well, healed you. Now, I don't know about you, but every time I've been bent and broken, that healing comes when I feel like my old self. It's not when the injury is gone or the surgery is completed and I'm all healed up, mended. The guy left, what do you reckon he did? Any ideas? It doesn't say, does it, in the passage? And I would like to think I would do the same thing, but time and time again, I see Jesus coming and holding and helping and delivering the request. And the next day, people are just back doing same old, same old. So what Jesus is most impressed with is what this guy did. Because when he says, your faith has healed you, Jesus is saying, I know your heart has been changed and you aren't going to be the same person you were before you came to me. And that's the important part of this message. Everyone hear this, that once Jesus comes into your heart, you aren't the same person. And don't you dare try to live the same life you did before. Oh, what an insult. In the psalm this morning, it talked about tasting. What when I say taste in a good way? Oh, I want to qualify this. Don't you yell liver unless it's true, okay? What's the favorite thing you love to taste? Do you have it? Yeah. What is it? Potato soup. He didn't say pizza. He said potato soup. That's a good choice. Anybody else? Chocolate. Woohoo! Delmer, what do you taste?
Have you ever seen a dead person dead and wake up and live again? I have.
Okay, what does that have to do with the question about taste? Taste. My question is, what's the best thing you've ever tasted? What's the best thing you've ever tasted? Sure. Uh-huh. Okay. Amen. Well, Delmer's talking about the accident his son had. He died in it. But you're telling me the story about what happened, true? Okay. Well, praise God and thank you for that personal testimony. Amen. But what I want to talk about is taste. In the psalm, we had taste. Taste and see. Do you think when you realize your faith has grown to a point to where you trust Jesus completely? Delmer, let me finish my sermon, please. You're right. It was Jesus all the way. Do you think you can taste faith? Have you ever thought about it? Can you taste faith? I would say yes. Well, this time of year, one of my favorite things to eat are those taffy apples with the nuts on them. Amen. I'm glad they're here. I did get a rotten one the other day, though. But the caramel and the nuts were still good. Just like that in my mind, the goodness and love of Jesus Christ prevails and lives in my heart. And that's my faith. So people, through those times when you taste your faith, live out Jesus. As Forrest Gump would say, that's about all I have to say about that. The Word of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. All right. Well, this morning, I want to lead us into our prayer time. It's kind of an announcement, but I celebrate. One of our in-town churches is celebrating 150 years of ministry today. And it's our brothers and sisters just over the tracks at the Presbyterian Church. And I put out a yee-haw for them. 150 years of Gibson City. The love of Christ being shared. Amen. Right? You're invited to stop by at the open house. Free doors are given away. That's what Ray told me. They're giving door prizes away. So if you need a door, go see them, okay? But I celebrate with that congregation, with my brothers and sisters in Christ. So just to put a bug in an ear, we're 150 years old, and I think we ought to do something about it sometime. Hey, talk to me. I've got an idea or two, okay? Another thing on my prayer request that we all, does anyone know what this thing with the pipes are called back here? Pipe organ. Hey, very good. A+. This one was built and rebuilt and put back together. Literally hundreds of thousands of dollars thrown into this piece of our church. You know what the biggest problem is with pipe organs today? biggest problem with that organ? Yeah, getting people to play the organ. Amen? Well, we have a newbie today, not a newbie to the organ, but to us. And it's Rona Ayers back here on the organ. I'm not trying to embarrass her at all. Praise God for her talents this morning. And guess what she gave us? Oh, God help you, Rona. Rona, you're going to probably regret the day you said yes. I don't know. But this congregation, I think we ought to show her a really nice round of applause for the thanks her sharing her talent. So Sandy and Bev and Rona, whoo, what a team, right? All right. See what else I know. I celebrate. I was on the interview team, one of the interview teams that Susan was with this week, and I told the folks that were on that team with me, I know you're going to laugh. I said, I'm going to shut up and not say a thing during this interview. And it was a wonderful, wonderful interview for our team. When the league came back together, it was unanimous. And I celebrate as Susan walks into this next adventure towards ordained ministry. So it's a big thing. Let me tell you a little bit about a deacon, okay? A deacon is not an elder. A deacon is not called to preach. A deacon is not called to do communion, sacraments. A deacon is called to help people find their way to Jesus. That's what her job is, and she does a great job at that, and we're blessed to have people like Susan doing those jobs. I also use that to say, you may not know it, but God knows it, that you're one of those persons that is going to help move the mission of the church forward here in Gibson City. And there was a time, I know it full and well, because Susan and I sat at a table in annual conference, and she was trying to discern her call. What am I supposed to be? I feel like giving up. I said, you don't want to give up, Susan. You'll miss the best time of your life. And look where she is today. Just mad at me as anyone can be. But let's celebrate Susan's blessings this week. Okay. Some farmers are getting done with beans, believe it or not. And some farmers are getting done with corn. Unbelievable. I know you're thinking, well, today's a fine example to keep farmers out of the field. Amen. It will dry up again. We will continue the harvest. We continue to pray for everyone in the agribusinesses, right? I don't know what we're going to do about another pandemic that is crushing us, especially in the United States. And that is not only violence, but gun violence right now. This week, again, we hear of accidents that have happened and someone died. That was in Hollywood. And down in Champaign-Urbana, best friends, as I read the story, best friends, almost a lifetime. One thought the other was pulling a gun, and the friend shot him, and he died. We have to somehow realize that love is a better way, people. Amen? And so I think that needs to be up on our prayer list. You ready to pray? You ready? Let me give you just a little time to center in, talk with Jesus. And Rona will play just a little under music so you can have that as part of your prayer time. Thank you. It's a short prayer this morning. I know there's tons of things we can pray about, but I want to lift up and praise you for what successes we had this week. Monday, when we got together and we had a meal in the church for the first time in over a year and a half. And all those people that really dug in and helped, I celebrate that. For opportunities in ministry like this meal that's coming up on November 16th, to invite all of those who have made a difference in someone else's life. And I want to stress this, those who went above and beyond during this flood in Gibson City. We're going to have soup and dessert, chili and vegetable soup, and honor those folks with a meal. Thank you. I celebrate that in our lives. I celebrate the ministry that continues in this church to make the larger church more strong and to deliver us in a place that we will continue for many, many years to do your work. I thank you for all the candidates that have stepped into the place, and as they look forward to commissioning at our next annual conference, we look forward to inviting them as our leaders into the United Methodist Church. I pray for our schools, for agribusiness. I pray for each one of you, for your successes and for the challenges, for the people who are struggling with any kind of addiction. But most of all, I pray for this one thing. The simple fact that Jesus is your son, and he says, we've been adopted. Thank you for loving us first, God, and loving us most. And thank you for hearing us as we pray like this. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen. I'd like to invite the ushers to come forward, please. Thank you. Thank you. Praise God from whom all blessings. Thank you. Praise him, all creatures here. Praise Father. You know, I lift up a praise for right after this service, the trustees are going to meet. And I don't mind to tell you, they're going to talk about this beautiful, wonderful place in the sanctuary. We have someone who has said they can fix it. Amen. And I don't know when it'll get fixed, but it will be fixed. And I'm just going to say this much. I was pleasantly surprised at the bid this person had shot us. It was only $110,000, folks. I'm kidding. No, don't go around. But I'm not going to tell you what. That would not be fair. But it was wonderful to hear. And we're going to be all right. And we'll be able to do it. And so I lift that, put it right in that collection plate for the gifts God gives us. Amen. So thank you for the ability to be able to be here today. I think about the people who aren't able to be here, and it is such a gift. I think this is the smallest number of people that we've had since I've been here. I wondered how long it'd take to catch on. And I know the reasons, it's just that season. So bless you for giving. Bless you. Bless you for asking and answering Jesus when he said, what do you need? Expect great things to happen this week, people, because God loves you. Amen. All right, let's sing our... Does anybody know this closing song, Coming Again? It is a EUB tune. Yes, I'm bringing our brothers and sisters from the United Brethren Church in. Elle and I were blessed to have an EUB church as one of our churches for 12 years, okay? I would love to say that in 1968 they merged with the Methodists, but I would be lying. They were still United Brethren when I was there. But one of the blessings I have is this song. I call it the All Skate, and you'll know why here in a minute, okay?
Yeah.
in our little EUB church was everybody, when that last one came, oh, what a wonderful day it will be. Then I'd hear the congregation go, because they did this. Jesus is come. Then you'd hear people dropping off, but there'd be that one lone soprano, coming again. Jesus is coming again. Amen. Hey, doesn't that excite you? There's hope for me. Brother, sister, let me serve you. Let me be as Christ to you. Pray that I may have the grace to let you be my servant too. And all of God's people say, amen. Have a wonderful week, guys. Hey, thanks for putting on your masks a week early. Halloween's next Sunday.